Hi everybody, in this new After Effects tutorial we're going to see some motion graphic techniques that I use to create this animation. We will see how they work, the structure behind, and how you can use them to create more depth in any of your motion graphics project. Also, thanks to Motion Array for sponsoring this video. Okay, we have this composition with a bunch of morphing solids. We will see in a few minutes how to animate them, but for now, we have them with some simple position keyframes connected to a null for the rotation. This will be the base element for our parallax, and to do it, it's quite simple. You just go to Layer, New, and create a camera. Then, from here, we change the view from active camera to top. Set our layers as a 3D layer, and let's create also a 3D null object to better move our camera. So, move the null object to match the position of the camera and parent the camera to the null object. Now we can set up our scene, so select the subject, in my case it's the same subject repeated, so I'll duplicate it 5 times. And then once we have them, we need to move them to create some distance between each layer. So like here I am setting the distance of 500 pixels from each other. Let's go back to our camera scene and we can see how now we have some visual depth. But I also want to add some atmospheric perspective. We just need to duplicate our background, set it as a 3D object, and then move it in front of each layer. So duplicate it and move again and again. These layers are a bit small, so let's increase the size. And also now they have the right place in the 3D space, but they block the view of the layers behind them. So we just need to lower the opacity to, let's say, 25. Okay, good. Now we can animate our camera by using the null object that we created as a controller. So we simply change the values of the position to zoom in and out in the scene. Let's also fix a little bit our curves. And then I want to delay each layer by just a couple of frames to create some timing offset. And that's it, we have our scene. In my case, I just wanted the camera to move forward, but obviously you can set it to move also by the side or as you wish. Another way to improve by a lot any motion graphics project is sound design. I've always been too lazy to do any sound design on my animation, but the reality is that that's an essential part to any video. And when I started doing even just a very basic sound editing, my videos have improved incredibly. My sound design system is quite simple. There is a lot of research to find the right sound effects that match correctly the visual action on the scene. So, finding the sound for every impact, transition, sliding, expansion, and so on. Then, in After Effects or Premiere, I just stack them one above the other in correspondence of their relative movement, while also using the waveform as a guide and reference to match their exact position. In case of a looping video like this, the sound effects at the end are cut and brought back to the beginning of the video, to help loop it and blend everything together. One of my favorite places to get some quality sound is Motion Array, who is sponsoring this video, and is one of the best service a motion designer can find. Because when you're a professional motion designer, it's of extreme help having a library full of high quality assets, like music, sound effect, or even motion graphic templates and visual effects that you can implement in your project to save hours of your time. Also, they have this amazing feature called the Motion Array Plugins Hub, which is a library with more than 50 effects and tools that you can install into After Effects and that you can use to quickly add color grading, remove green screen, and a lot of other different actions that can be a huge help for your projects and that can save you hours of time. So check out Motion Array, and if you use the link in the video description, you can have a $50 discount on your annual subscription plan. Now back to our tutorial. To create our system, we need to start from Illustrator because drawing here is way easier than to do it in After Effects. We just need to draw the shape that composes a cylinder without any perspective distortion. Then copy, go to After Effects, select the pen tool, click in any point of the composition and paste it. Scale up because this is a little bit small, and duplicate because one will be the top of our solid, the other the bottom. And then change the colors to distinguish them. Then repeat the process with all the other remaining shapes for the sides of the solid. Once we have them all, let's rearrange them to rebuild our cylinder. And recolor the layers again to visually organize them better. Now let's animate the shape path to morph between a base circle shape to a square, so that we can morph between shapes during our animation later. So just by using the vertex tool, by clicking on a corner, we transform our circle to a square. And then do the same on every curve of every layer. Let's lower the opacity to see better what's happening, and okay, we got a solid that morphs between a cylinder and a parallelepiped. And now the interesting part. Go to Windows and open the panel Create Nulls from Path. Select the first shape path, click on Point Follows Nulls, and After Effects will create four null objects that control the position of our shape points. Now we have to repeat this for the path of every layer, and then we can rename them to organize our timeline a bit. I'm using North, South, West and East letter for the top and bottom layer that will be the controllers of the solid, and just ABCD for all the others. As you can see, the nulls control our shape while maintaining the morphing between square to circle. Anyway, now to complete our rig, we need to parent every null that controls the side to its relative nulls from the top and bottom layer. So, for example, our side 1B matches the position of bottom west, and so on for all the others. After parenting every null, we do not need them anymore in our timeline, so we can hide them because our top and bottom nulls control every shape now. Let's add a new null object and position it right in the center of the top. Rename it and parent all the top nulls to it. Then do the same also for the bottom. And now we have two null objects that controls the top and the bottom rotation and position. Let's create a last null object that we can call total scale. And we can parent to it the top rotation and bottom rotation nulls. By scaling everything, this null controls the fake perspective of our solid, while the top and the bottom null control the height and the rotation. The only limit of this rigging at the moment is that the Bezier curves of the shapes are not correctly affected by the two nulls, so we have to be a little bit careful when rotating or when scaling with a circular shape. So maybe I'll try to make another video in the future to solve this problem with a slightly different rigging. Anyway, now we can start animating our solid. First of all, I copied along the timeline the morphing between squares and circles. And then I started animating the scale of the main controller and the position of the two nulls. But how to animate the system is totally up to you, so I'm just playing around a little bit. A fun thing to do is just to put some extra keyframe around to have the shape bounce and overshoot a little bit. And also put some time offset between the keyframes, so that one side moves slightly before than the other and creates some timing offset. Okay, I also pre-composed everything and applied a rotation, even though probably I could have done that in the original composition. After that, for my project, I created some more solids. Some are simply made with animated mask shapes, while others are based on this rigging system we've just seen. And now it's time to style everything, so I want to apply on each layer a gradient ramp and apply my color palette on it. Then I want to keyframe the position of the gradient ramp and change it accordingly to the solid rotation and position. Only for this first layer, I want to duplicate it and change the color slightly to have more tone variation. Then I can just apply a mask to have them as lights and shadows in the corners. And as we did for the gradient ramp's position, we also need to animate the mask path. Okay, now just copy our gradient ramp on every face of the solid and change it slightly to color differently the faces. After a lot of copy and paste, I have my set of basic solids. And this is our main animation with the same gradient ramp pasted on its layers. Okay, we have this new rotating solid animation. The first half, when it's a cylinder, is just two masked shapes. The second half, when it becomes a cube, is done with our rig system. To that, I also added a null controller to add some rotation, and I also already applied the same gradient ramp we used previously for the colors. What we want to achieve here is the effect of a solid inside another solid, so let's drag into the composition the solid animation we did before and split it in the middle so that we can have one half on the cylinder shape and the other on the cube. If you have a single solid, you can avoid splitting. Obviously, every project and context is different. Anyway, let's make it orange to recognize it, and now we can start. Basically, we just need to duplicate our inner solid and use the shape of the outer solid as a matte. Now we can scale it, move it, and even apply some effect, like a blur effect. And we will get this nice transparency distortion effect, since every side of the outer solid will show a slightly different image. So now the job is very simple. We just need to put, according to our taste, some keyframes to animate the scale, the position, the blur of our inner subject. Or if you want, even the colors and light, but for this tutorial I kept it quite simple. An important thing to keep in mind is that with the cylinder it was way easier, but with this fake 3D rig the shape layers constantly go back and forth, so we need to cut the subject and reset every time the matte layers, with the one that is shown at that precise moment. But other than that, we just need to play around a bit and again setting up the keyframe for scale, position, blurs and distortions. Okay, we have our animation, but now we only need just a final touch. I want to duplicate the entire composition to use it as a displacement map. So once we have a copy, we can eliminate our smaller subject as we need as a map only the bigger one. Then we can remove all the color effect and the gradient ramp from every layer. And we need to recolor everything with 50% gray. Now we can select one layer and go to Layer Style and click on Bevel and Emboss to create this black and white border on it. Change the setting and values a little bit. Okay, and now we can copy and paste the layer style on every single layer to create these light and dark corners everywhere. Again, we have to do some cutting to fix our cube, but nothing too crazy. And now we have our displacement map that, as you can see, fits perfectly with our original one. So let's turn the layer off and add an adjustment layer. On this adjustment layer, apply the effect displacement map and set as a source layer our gray displacement composition. Increase the values by how much it works for you to create these beautiful distortions around the edges of the bigger solid. And we're done. So thanks very much for watching this video. Check the video description where you can find the project files with the rig system ready to be used, and also your link to get $50 off from your Motion Array subscription. Please subscribe to the channel to not miss the next video, and let me know in the comments if there is some topic you would like to see a video about.